Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is still morning, another 5 minutes to go. Welcome this morning to our Government Affairs Council and to an opportunity to hear from our superintendents of education in our area to find out a little bit more about what's happening in education and what they see in the future in educational development for our community. I want to thank this morning our presenting sponsors for this forum, Portland General Electric and Riverview Community Bank. I want to thank also our education sponsor. How appropriate for an education meeting today that we should be sponsored by an education school district, and that is the Gresham-Barlow School District. And I want to thank our MetroEast media people who are here to tape this program and air it on their channel. So without sponsors such as these, we would not be able to provide these forums to our community. So a special thank you to those organizations that make this possible for us every month to enrich our community and broaden our knowledge on different areas of government. We have a few elected officials in our class, yes, the teacher coming out of me. We have a few elected officials in our audience this morning. If you're an elected official, whether you're a state, a municipal, a federal, elected, a government, school district, if you're elected, would you stand and just be recognized this morning? See, Mayor Bemis. Thank you, Mayor. Glad to have you here this morning. And this morning, I would like to recognize our chamber board members. If you're a board member, would you stand? Werner Allen, Dr. Durr, Jim Hathaway, Athena Vadnais, and John Maloney, if you're here. These individuals contribute to the operation of our chamber and our board activities, and we appreciate them. And this morning, it gives me great pleasure to be able to introduce you to our new Chief Executive Officer for the Gresham Chamber of Commerce, Lynn Snodgrass. I'm personally indebted to Lynn because now I get to go back to retirement. But if something else develops, who knows? I'm always open, but retirement is good too. thank you, Lynn. Thank you. At this point, I'd like to turn the program over to our good friend, Werner Allen, who is the head of our Government Affairs Office, who is now our new president for the Gresham Chamber of Commerce. Werner.
Let me echo good mornings to everyone. Thanks for coming to what I think will be an informative and interesting presentation by our superintendents. On my right is the superintendent of Centennial School District, Mr. Sam Breyer, who has spent 7 years at Centennial, both as a principal, as someone charged of school improvements, and for the last 3 years as the superintendent of the Centennial School District. Prior to that, he taught elementary school in the Gresham-Barlow District. I don't know why he left.
He's well trained.
but he was well trained. On my immediate left is Linda Florence, who's the superintendent of Reynolds School District, and is to be congratulated for the passage of your bond measure. And in reading this bio, I am remiss in not saying that it's Dr. Linda Florence. Linda's background includes 20 years in administration in Oregon and has taught school before that, both in the Oregon areas as well as in the Midwest. So we thank you very much for all your good hard work. And on my far left is Superintendent Jim Schlachter, who, as we know, is the superintendent of the Gresham-Barlow School District. If you haven't seen the letters to the editor in the Outlook today, there's one from Jim Schlachter urging us all to be proactive in working on our legislators and increasing the budget. So Jim, as we know, has been with the Reynolds community as the superintendent, Gresham-Barlow, I'm sorry. there, that works hard. Yeah, I did. And prior to that, as some teacher told me before going on to the dark side, he taught school as a science and math teacher. So would you please welcome this panel to our podium and look forward to hearing what you have to say.
Good morning, everyone, or it's afternoon now. And I am the first one up here, Linda Florence from Reynolds School District, just in case you think Jim is over there. So we have some slides to share, and we have some good news, bad news type of things, which we'll be talking about. And so what I always like to do is you want to get over with the bad news first on what's happening in school districts. And as you probably are aware, we have been working very hard this year on budget. In a time when our economy has really been good in the state of Oregon, those in education have had to, some of us have had to make cuts, and some of us have said, okay, I think we can go ahead and show that it's even. However, a lot of people who aren't in education have no idea why, when we get a 9% increase in school budget, that districts would be cutting. So I thought I would start out with a few slides that kind of show this in case you're unaware. So the first slide, you can see that in comparing our previous, this current biennium and the future one, 2013-15 to 15-17, last biennium we had $6.65 billion that we were working with, and this year, actually it's a little bit above this because it keeps changing, but this is the number that we took to our budget committee, $7.255 billion. Yes, that's a 9% increase on paper. In the next slide, you can see what's happened to K-12 share of the budget and also all education. What has happened over time during the past six bienniums. So back in 2003-05, all education had nearly 60% of the piece of the pie from the state of Oregon. K-12 had about 45%. Since then, it's gone down. So the piece of the pie has kept getting less instead of more as prices have increased. So now, this year, for this next biennium, 2015-17, we're actually at the 39.1% level. So from the last biennium to this, even though our part has increased 9%, it's actually decreased in the piece of pie. So 39.7% to 39.1%. So for Reynolds School District, the amount of increase that we actually got is not 9%. It's a 0.44%. And later on, I'll show you that's $30 per student. So when we get online to say how much money will be coming into the district extra for this biennium, how much is that going to be? How much will the bank at the state transfer into our bank account? And it's $30 per student. So if you take a look over time what our state school fund, that's the SSF amount per weighted student, and that means some students receive more money than others because of either disabilities or if they're second language speakers or in poverty. You can see from 2012-13 that we received $6,063 per student. And currently $6,900 per student. Now, the state did something different this year, too, to help offset the lower money that the districts are receiving. In the past, we've always received 49% the first year of the biennium and 51% for the second year of the biennium because costs increase. This year, they gave us 50-50. Which means we would get a little additional the first year, but we would really have a plunge the second year. So there are districts who are still using the 49-50, saving the money so that they don't go off the cliff the second year. In Reynolds School District, we budgeted 49.5% to 50.5% because we know that we generally have carryover that can help us into that second year. We don't know where the extra money will be going yet that is coming in from the state. We know it's going to be placed in year two, but we don't know what kind of attachments will be to that money. In other words, we may not be able to spend it simply in the district per student. It may be specifically for something else. It could be professional development, could be for mentoring. There's some strings attached to those. This next slide shows in millions for Reynolds School District. So you can see in the last 2 years it would remain the same, the state allocation, that is without property taxes. So what does this mean to the district? Well, 2 years ago, we started implementing all-day K before we got the money to implement all-day K. This year, starting July 1, will be the first year that we're required to have all-day K in all of our schools. So we got ahead of the game. We already was able to budget for all-day K. So we've had it in place now. Half of our schools 2 years ago, this past year, all of our elementary schools. So we don't have that added burden, that added cost for all-day K. At this point, we're saying we're getting some money back now in order to pay for what we've already used in the past 2 years. Other districts haven't been so fortunate. They're starting it this year, which is a huge cost to them, and that's why a lot of districts are cutting. So how do we manage, even though we're getting $30 per student extra, how do we manage and put together our budget? And this is what we do every year. We start out with this year, or this coming year, our operating budget is just over $123 million. We also get title, federal grants. Reynolds is a very high poverty district. We have large percentages of all those subgroups that would get extra money. So I know that Jim is always saying, you know, we have more students than you, and you bring in more money. Well, yeah, we have high-cost students in our district, and it's true, and I'm not certain where your budget is coming into this next year, but this is us all together. So our idea and our philosophy in the district is we budget a plan. So back in December, we bring plans to our school, to the school board, on what needs to be done in order to do the best for each and every child. So the board has 4 budget goals, and they're student achievement, equity, fiscal responsibility, and communication. So the types of funding that we use actually goes toward those areas, and they always, in every one of our those board goals and budget goals, we use the board superintendent action plan and everything in there in order to fund, you know, specific planned out activities. We look that we will have proficient readers by the end of third grade, so a lot of extra money goes K-3. We also believe that athletics and activities are very important to well-rounded students, so we make sure that money is funneled toward that end, too. So we have been bringing back middle school sports and activities that had been cut back in 2010. We have also worked with designing and bringing to fruition Caring Schools Community Initiative, and that is covers a lot of different areas, but we're really looking at mental health for our students. So we have added extra money for mental health and ways to help kids do well in school, regardless of what is happening at home or in their communities. Technology has been huge, and we've put a lot of money into technology. Across the district, we have a two students to one device initiative, and we have that through ninth grade now for this year, and then we'll be finishing it off next year, K-12, because we know that our digital learners really do much better when they have a device in their hand and to be able to go into those next levels. One of the things that was interesting this year, it was the first year of Smarter Balance, and that is all on some device. So everything they do on an iPad, laptop, computer. Well, our kids did a great job because they're used to the technology, and that was really helpful. And we're also looking at extended learning and dropout prevention programs and to continue investment in current textbook, e-text, and instructional materials. We have similar long lists of things that we've worked on in this budget under equity, fiscal responsibility, and communication. So the bad news for Reynolds School District is that it's not so bad. So it's actually moderately okay. We can live through this. What we haven't been able to do is decrease class sizes, which are way too high, just way too high. And we haven't been able to add the personnel in order to help relieve some of the pressure that teachers have when they have a third grade class of 30 to 32 students in it. We are not able to add instructional assistants. So our hope is maybe the next biennium, if the state opens up the coffers a little bit for K-12. But the real good news is, and thank you for the applause, is we just won that bond election. Very briefly, because I don't know how much time I have, I will go through what we did to get where we were on May 19th, 2015. And one of our members who worked so hard is right here, and Andrea Watson. This is her first day back. She took 2 weeks off. She had to come down off that 100-day crazed mission that she had in order to do the campaigning. But back in October 2013, we began our facilities master plan, and we hired a firm to do this for us, and we had engineers and architects work on every single building and come up with a plan for that building and what was needed. This was the work of a committee of community members, staff, and administrators who went from building to building and really looked at that along with the architects and engineers. That plan was adopted by the board in October 2014. And we found that we had nearly $500 million in projects. And we knew that we're not Beaverton and we're not Portland Public. Our voters would not approve $500 million, nor could they afford it. So we ended up meeting in November of 2014. We had five different meetings, and our Facilities Community Task Force, known as our FACT, because we told them we wanted the facts, and they prioritize the projects. And so we have four phases, and they chose what phase one would be that they believe should go to the voters. During that time, we also did a Nelson survey to see what the public, what our voters would support. And they were very supportive on paper of the projects when it came to safety and replacement of schools. And it was anywhere from 65% to 75% in favor. As you know, I think our outcome wasn't quite there. In December of 2014, we had those projects in place, and then the FACT committee recommended phase one to the school board in January. In February 2015, the board approved the general obligation bonds for $125 million in projects at May 19, 2015 election. And this was projected to be $1.56 per 1,000, or the same as the 2014 tax rate for the district. It was much easier asking for $125 million when there'd be no increase to taxes. People said, oh, well, that's a given. That's not a problem. But I don't think they voted yes at that point. because it was kind of a low turnout. So May 19th, our construction bond passed, and we were, you know, it was kind of, it was a very slow to celebration type of process, because after 8 o'clock that evening on the 19th, we got our first results, and we were 20 votes behind. And it was like, whew, you know, all the energy and enthusiasm was just kind of taken out. Kind of lost our breath. And then at 9:30, we had a second results coming in, and we were 15 votes behind. So we stayed on until after 11, when the third results came in, and our campaign chair said, oh, she acted excited. It's two. We got it by two. And it's like, we're down two votes now. You know, I mean, it was really kind of a difficult to swallow this. And she goes, no, we're at 51%, 49%. We're 2 percentage points apart in favor. And it's like, okay, it's going the right direction. So the end result was we have about 300 votes, yes, affirmative, above. So it's really a 52-48. But I think what I wanted to say about that is, even though when those surveys come back and it shows really positive, you really have to be careful even with those positive numbers and work crazy, because we did, and in order just to get that 2% in order to win that. I mean, I know we could be Park Rose and have 6 votes that were, yes, above that 50% level. So this vote means that we will be able to replace 3 of our oldest elementary schools. Troutdale and Fairview are 88 years old. They will be replaced. Kids can still go to school there until the new building opens, because fortunately, a long time ago, our district was really progressive and got enough land that we could build on half of it. We can take the school down and put in the parking lots and the playgrounds for them. So, and then Wilkes Elementary School is 101 years old. It needs replacement because most of the students are not in the school there. They're in portables. So it'll be good to have a new school on that property as well, and away further away from the freeway. If this also brings $35 million in projects to our high school, which is 750 students over capacity. It'll bring 18 new classrooms. It's going to remodel our science labs. It's going to put in a new entryway into the school that will connect the main school to the gymnasiums. And in all of our schools, we will have secure vestibules. We'll have new security cameras and lighting and automatic secure door locks for outside door locks. So we're really looking forward to these next steps. It's great being in Reynolds. It's great throwing a budget together and saying we're still going forward and meeting our goals. And it's great to have community support. So thank you very much.
Well, good afternoon, and thank you for the chance to come and talk with you. I wanted to mention before we start, bringing 3 superintendents together in East County is not as difficult as you would think. We actually work together quite frequently. In fact, of the 6 large districts in Multnomah County, we spend quite a bit of time together. What's encouraging to me in terms of being here today is that quite often when we're brought together, it's Portland-centric. It tends to be groups that are really driven by the interest of Portland, and so often we're the lone voices from East County at the table trying to make sure that we get equal resources, particularly when we're at the county level. And so it's nice to see on the east side the bringing together of educational leaders to the key folks in the community to have honest, clear conversation about education, because it's certainly of interest to this county. We are not as competitive as you would think, except on the athletic field where Gophers and Bruins tend to rule. But apart from that, we get along on most things. It's important to note, I'll start with mine in terms of the mission. It is the intent of our district and has been since 2015 to really focus on this concept of preparing every student for success by whatever measure that takes. And I'm going to try to frame my comments this morning around that, because if that's not at the center of what our interest is, then quite often you get mired into either there's too much resource, too little resource, who has the loudest voice in terms of what's best for kids. So if I were to frame my comments, I would put every student prepared for success in the middle. We have to always keep that in front of us. But I would put on top of this triangle our district vision. We have to define what it is we are after. Again, in education, I'm convinced there will never be enough resource. We will always be having this conversation of not enough. But what you do get, it's important that you put it in the right areas if you're going to have any kind of progress. And so I'll talk a little bit about that vision, and particularly a key point we're in right now as a district. The second one, I'll talk about the operations, the annual budget, what is state controlled. And that's what your questions were to us when we arrived. And so I'll answer those three questions about what the current state funding level, the impact that has on our programs as we move to the future. And I'll finish talking, much like Linda, from the other end of the perspective, as we launch this evening our bond development committee for a potential 2016 bond measure. So I'll talk briefly about that. So district vision. For the last 5 years, we've operated off of what we call strategic themes. So whether it be the staffing levels we have, the programs we adopt, whatever, and I don't expect you to read this, but the point being, there were kind of six areas of focal points where we would make decisions around, budget decisions, staffing decisions, those kinds of things. But that was developed in 2010, and much has changed in the world of K-12 education. Well, I would argue much has changed in the world in general. But in the education world, a lot of things are different today, and as we project out to 2020, will be much different then. So we put together a group over the course of this year, and this is just a draft. Our board will look at this information, and then we will launch a 2020 vision next fall. But the focal areas are the key points as we brought together, I think maybe some of the folks in this room, staff, parents, et cetera. We came up with a new set of some key areas that as we look at the next 5 years, they're key. Related to talking to a chamber, I will draw just a few to your attention, college and career readiness. While we have always seen that as part of our goal for our graduates, there is really increased focus on what does that mean. For a long time, I think throughout our country, high school's quite often been perceived as the next step to college. If you look at the data, that's not where the majority of the kids are going. Many of them are, some are going to community colleges, and partway through they get jobs. A lot are going directly into the workforce. And so our high schools and our K-12 system as a whole needs to keep that in mind as we prepare students for the future, that it's just not about entrance into Oregon State or Oregon. It is really about how can you be a productive member of your community through whatever education or job you will get. So that's a real key one that's in there. The other one, because I'll finish with the facility thing, is the community investment piece. What this group kept saying, and I wrote it these terms because bonds come and go, what they kept saying is bond. We need to pass a bond. We need to pass a bond. All the stakeholders were saying that. We retitled it community investment because bond is one act in what really needs to be a long-term attitude within a community that says that our schools and our school facilities reflect the values of the community and will in fact elevate the worth and the value of not only property but of quality of life. And that we need to have a continual effort through the help of the school district to renew those opportunities, to get those facilities up to speed, to make sure that we're a proud community of our facilities. And so that's a key one on this. Operations or annual budget, I appreciate that Linda covered this to some degree, so I don't have to talk about it as much. But I will answer the three questions that were asked, at least in the email that I received. This is a slide much like Linda's. The reality is the legislature did increase K-12 funding by 9%. But with the various pieces that she mentioned, the 50-50 split, all of the different things, in reality, per student for us, it's 0.9% increase. And that really doesn't cut it when it comes to your normal roll-up cost. You know that within your businesses, your companies, 0.9% from year to year really means you need to downsize because you can't keep your contract moving forward. But I will mention the three questions you asked. What is the state now, the state budget for education? It's roughly a little more than this, but it's all being backloaded onto the second year. So 7.255 is what was passed and signed by the governor. Since that, through the economic forecast, they estimate it's worth about 7.355. The added dollars would be put in the second year of the biennium, so it's creating that 50-50 split to what is probably a little bit more like a 50, you know, this is more than 100%, but just for illustration, the backside is probably up to 51. Our budget that was adopted and will be sent to the school board Thursday night really will require that the state get to 7.4. And we're pretty much given assurance down there from a lot of folks who at least tell us they know a lot, that that's where they're gonna land. We really need 7.5 not to have made some difficult decisions. For example, we are not able to renew a middle and high school English language arts curriculum in the next biennium like we did elementary in the current, because it's not at 7.5. We weren't able to add staffing at the high school level, even though the enrollment was slightly down. We actually had to reduce some positions. Doesn't raise class size, because enrollment is a little bit lower at the high school level. But it put us in a tough position in terms of not really having the resources to move forward the way we would like to. But at the same time, you know, my appeal, whether it be in the letter to the editor or other places, legislators need to be reminded that their work is not done. Until they get a little bit more behind K-12, they are in fact impacting K-12 education throughout the state. So I tend to try to keep the heat on them. Second question, what effect will it have on local schools? For us, not so much on class size, because again, we're able to retain teachers based upon enrollment as much as possible, but it slows down things like needed adoption of curriculum we cannot do. Some other examples of some things, we would like to really beef up a mentoring program for our younger teachers. Those take dollars. It's hard to cut teachers so that you can mentor other teachers. So without added dollars, there are things that we cannot do. What is the action plan for the school district? Well, for us, it's really to build around those vision statements and to really target the money then on those things that matter and really focus on how do we do them well, whether it's college and career readiness, early learning, equity, all of those things are, that's really our plan. So I'll move to facility improvements. So we are at the exact opposite end of Reynolds in that we are, in fact, and a couple of you in the room will actually be there tonight, launching our bond measure development committee. You'll recognize these buildings. I won't put you through a quiz, but these are three of our older buildings. And age is part of the issue. Sometimes it's just they were never built to become old. North Gresham is a good example. It may not be as old as the others, but at the time, I think they spent as little as possible to get a walls and a roof. And at some point, you get a building like that. And while it may not be incredibly old, although it's still old, how much money do you want to put into something like that versus do what Reynolds has successfully done is to identify three schools for replacement. So those are the kind of things our bond development committee have to wrestle with. And they are truly going to wrestle with and put together a recommendation for our board based upon what they see and what they expect. You know, what do you do with Gresham High? You certainly don't tear it down. It's an iconic old school, one of the oldest in the state of Oregon. But how do you transform it into a school that works? If you know students who attend there, you know that while they may be getting a good education based upon the coursework, the instruction, what they're not getting is a quality experience at all facilitated by the facility. It is pathetic. West Gresham's another good example. It's a great drive-by school. I mean, you drive by and there's just a little bit of a feel of, wow, that's kind of like old school, isn't that neat? Spend a day there. And you'll be first in the list to say, how quickly can you replace this facility? So those are the issues we'll be wrestling with. As we look at that, heavy community involvement. There are many opinions whenever an election, bond election, fails of why it would have. It's probably some combination of so many different reasons that you really can't capture it. But in looking back to the 2013 bond measure that did not pass, in addition to the, all the other things we couldn't control, The one piece that I think we're really trying to build up this time is the level of community input in the development of the bond. And that is, in the words of my CFO, Mike Schofield, we will put in front of the voters whatever will pass. So the community group that we're bringing together needs to help us understand what is that, how much to Barlow, how much to Gresham. You know, we talked about competition between the districts. To be honest, when you're in a two high school district, we have three, but the two big comprehensive, you've got the competition internal with your own communities. The Barlow community doesn't necessarily have as big a heart for the Gresham need as they do their own. And while one may, in reality, need a lot more work than the other, that doesn't mean the Barlow will vote yes. So this committee has to wrestle with that piece, is how do you engage both the Barlow and the Gresham community and put something in front of them they will both agree is worth their investment. And so that's the work of this committee. We're real excited about that. We've already started this year. Athena, myself, and Mike, the CFO, visited every single school and talked with the staff and got a lot of data that we'll be sharing tonight. And part of the process that we're now engaging in will include staff and community meetings at every single school next fall. So you'll be getting plenty of information, inviting you to come out to the school of choice or more than one and hear what's in it for this school, what will that look like, is it worthy of my vote or my support. To be quite honest, lesson two from the past bond, if the community's not behind the bond, it will not pass. It doesn't matter how good it looks on paper or how many times I talk, if the community doesn't believe it's the real deal and tell their neighbors and tell their friends, it will not pass. And so that's a piece that we're going to be working on. So again, coming back to why are we in this business, we want every student to be prepared for success. My guess is the data at Centennial and Reynolds will be very much like ours. But by and large, our graduates come back. They go to college, they go to the workforce, whatever. But you start surveying groups of people, which I've done frequently at meetings, Barlow and Gresham grads are huge in number in this community. And so we really believe preparing them for success is not only a good thing statewide, nationally, or globally, but it's a very good thing locally because we want well-prepared citizens in Gresham-Barlow area. So with that, I will hand it off to Sam.
Thank you, Jim. So as an educator, I'm always sensitive when I'm the last person to speak, and you've been sitting and listening for a long time. So I will keep my remarks pretty short and attempt not to duplicate a lot of what you've heard, because in reference to what Jim said, we do all work together a lot. We all try and do the best things for students, so we could talk about many of the same things over and over, and I will attempt not to do that to you. What I will do is share how those things look and what they mean in the Centennial context. So in terms of the first questions that we were asked to speak about, the funding status, I told you I'd keep it simple. For us, you heard already what it means, 9%, but with the addition of full-day kindergarten and other things. For Centennial, it will be a $26 increase per student in the coming year, which is 0.3%. Not 3%, 0.3%. And with the 50-50 split, it would be a 0% increase in the year after. That's based on the projected 7.255 that are the only ones we've received so far. The effect in Centennial for that, effect and how we are choosing to deal with it, in 15-16, we can maintain progress. And I put the word progress there. I'm the one who typed it. Now I'm wishing I typed momentum there. We made a very conscious choice this year not to make reductions in the first year for a couple reasons. In a time of tight economic downturn where we've reduced over 20% of our staff, we really have made progress as a district. Our district graduation rate has gone up 16 points in the last 5 years. We are now above the state average. Two of our schools are rated at the highest level in the state. They're termed model schools, top 10% of the schools in the state. And I believe if they were rating schools again this year, they're not because of the change in testing, we would have a third school entering. And so we are on a great path. And last year, when we had a little bit more to invest, when there was a small uptick in funding, recognizing that we had made a lot of the big systematic changes for that moment, momentum, we intentionally made some small investments in a couple specific areas. And those areas were to intervene as early as possible for kids, because that's where you get the most impact. And so we started the progress towards full day kindergarten at all of our schools, so our kids will be reading by third grade. This year, as part of maintaining progress, we are implementing that district-wide. Another piece is we have made big gains in graduation rate at the high school. The next leverage point to really emphasize there is kids in ninth grade coming out of eighth grade into ninth grade, and so we made some investments in some ninth grade support. When you put those kind of investments in place, it's hard to then immediately cut them the next year before you've seen the impact. And so we chose to maintain that progress, as well as the second part, which is making sure that our kids have options when they leave our school. They are prepared for something beyond. I talk all the time, my job as a K-12 superintendent is not to graduate kids, it's to make sure they have a successful life after they leave our schools. And so another investment we made is an expansion of our career technical education program. That was done with a state grant funding, which is fantastic, but the grants last for 18 months and then the money goes away. And so we intentionally chose not to reduce what we had just beefed up, but to pay for that as well and to continue that in the current year, because we have students leaving our metals program right now through partnerships with large industry, walking out of our high school, going to work at Vigor and Daimler and linking right into jobs. So we wanted to maintain that progress and momentum now. What that meant originally is that next year we would be staring at a $3 million cliff. With the new information of up to $7.36 billion, that's about a $1.5 million cut we would have to make next year if we were to simply roll everything over. A lot can change as estimates and things come in, so there may be some room within that. It also gives us a year to work with our community and to really look strategically at what programs are having an impact and what aren't. I will say, with what we have wrung out of our school district for the last 5 years, the concept that there's anything that you can cut that is not going to have an impact on students just isn't true. And so this will give us a little more time to figure out what reductions can we make that minimize the impact on students and hopefully help us maintain our momentum. And so with this plan, as it sits right now, that would be the effect. And as we would deal with it, as I said, we would continue to analyze our data and our outcomes on a real tight basis. That's what we do when we put money back into the system. That's what we need to do when we take it out. And we will work with our community to identify possible reductions. As Jim said, I'm very hopeful that number continues to go up and we get to the point where that reduction is smaller or non-existent, so we continue the progress and continue to offer the best possible service for students. So that's the reality of our current reality. We're also planning and dealing with the future, as both of my colleagues talked about. And if you've been through Centennial lately, the future is growth. There are houses going up, particularly on the southeast side of our community, in the Gresham portion of the Centennial community, to the point that we're projected to grow by 1,000 students in the next 5 to 7 years. That's a more than 15% increase in capacity in our district, which is absolutely a wonderful positive thing. We're very excited about that. With the addition of full day kindergarten, our schools are at capacity as of fall of next year. So we actually are kind of right in between the two extremes that we talked about, where we did convene a facility task force this year, a team, and I do want to recognize Joan Albertson, who was one of our community representatives on the team. She is here. Thank you, Joan. She gave many nights. We conducted dozens of meetings, including staff and community meetings at all of our schools. The facility team met on a regular basis. As is always the case, when you're talking about public buildings, and 9 of our 10 school buildings are 40 or more years old, some are more than 100 years old. So there are needs there. Identified hundreds of dollars worth of needs that we would love to take care of. Recognizing that that's not going to happen, the team then did some work and did multiple community surveys where we prioritized what the needs are. And so for us, I don't expect you to read all of that. For us, the priorities came out. The first one is to build a new school. So when you're looking at that kind of capacity increase, that could actually require multiple schools. Fortunately, in Centennial, we have an option that allows us to meet the community need by building a single new school. We currently are configured as K-6 elementary schools. We have one middle school, which is 7th and 8th grade students only. It has 1,000 7th and 8th grade students, which I have nightmares about, but it does, and it runs well. It is one of our level 5 schools in the district, actually. But if we were to build a new middle school and move our 6th grades up and had two 6-8 middle schools, then by building one school, we are able to open capacity across the entire district. And so that was the first recommendation. Additionally, was to increase, to build some multi-purpose spaces at a few of our elementary schools that do not have a separate gym and cafeteria, because that would allow us to add some more capacity, schedule more classes, and our community is desperate for more community use spaces. Our schools that have basketball spaces are scheduled nonstop, and so opening up more of those and getting the community more in is a priority for the school district and our community as well. With those two pieces, we are able to address the capacity estimates for Centennial for the next 10 years by doing those two things. Additionally, safety and security was a big issue for our community as well. And so talking about many of the upgrades that Linda addressed in terms of making all of our schools as safe as possible. Also, when we're talking about old buildings, we have maintained our buildings well. We're not talking about replacing any of our buildings, although they probably could use it for many of the reasons Jim described. But there are some things that need to be replaced or updated. Primarily, when we talk about preparing our students for the future, and technology is a big issue, 50-year-old buildings don't support that. They don't even support plugging in computers, let alone running everything else. And so there are some infrastructure needs there. And then an additional need that was important to our community was maintaining and upgrading our athletic facilities. And so that's something that came out as incredibly important, and part of the discussion is how do you pay for that, whether that's a community bond or whether that is fundraising, matching, corporate sponsors, that kind of thing. So these were the initial recommendations. The questions are how we fit those all into what we can afford, and the board is wrestling with those concepts now. So as I said, we aren't quite to a bond, but we're past the facility planning process. So I look forward to working with the community on this, and I look forward to continue supporting the Centennial community. And I believe that concludes our presentation, and we'd be happy to take any questions now. Okay, so this is why they put me last. So I was up here for the PERS question, I think. I always get launched into the PERS question. So it's going to vary by district. The estimates right now are, in the immediate future, it doesn't have an impact because the PERS biennial rates are already set. So the impact will happen the next time the PERS board convenes and resets the rates. At this point, we're told to expect about a 5 to 5.5% rate increase. For Centennial, that would be over $500,000 a year. Larger.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I believe his $3 million is over the course of the biennium, so it would be over $1 million for me.
Right. Oh. And ours is the same, and it's Gresham because we're about the same size, and we also put additional money into reserves, so we would not be, we have it there available.
The large number Jim quoted, Mayor Bemis, was over the course of the biennium. Mine was per year, so it would be over $1 million per year for Centennial.
Hi, I have a question for you. I'm involved with an East Metro group. Mark Reith behind me is part of that group as well, doing some work and trying to create a STEM hub. Mm-hmm. So I'm really, really supportive of opportunities for students to go down the CTE path or into some sort of post-secondary. But the real issue first is, how do we graduate them? How do we get them to stay in school to be able to pursue some of that? And so I just wondered, graduation rates haven't been the best in recent years. I'm hoping that they're going up, but is there something you're doing about just keeping kids in school so that they can be exposed to those other opportunities?
Yeah, I think any of us could answer that. So graduation rates are going up, which is the good news. For us in Centennial, as I said, we addressed that in a couple different ways. One was really putting intentional intervention systems in place for students so they had the skills to graduate. That's how we've made some real gains. And now it's really about looking and supporting them before they experience systemic failure for a long time. A student who is an 11th grader who has one or two high school credits has virtually no chance of graduating and often gives up. And there's no reason we shouldn't be identifying and supporting that in the 9th grade year. So we are investing in doing that as well. And actually linking to what you're talking about around STEM, part of the work too is giving students clear pathways to success, which I know all of our districts have done different types of work on, but that includes giving them career paths and options in STEM and career technical education careers. And we are working to make them aware of those opportunities in middle school, going into high school with their families as well. So it's about building support systems, but also building relevance for students and families in that.
I'm hoping that that's an incentive for them to stay.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, and I think there's...
Thank you, and I would agree completely with what Sam said, but there's really two other issues related to that, getting students through high school and on to the next phase, particularly around STEM and CTE. And that is, over the last 5 years, as a result of decreased funding, so the loss of 15 to 20% of your staff, given your high school requirements, some of the programs that go are CTE. It's not that the students don't want those courses, but they have to have the math, the science, the language arts, et cetera. So some of the opportunities that quite often are those very opportunities that motivate students to stay in school are not available to them. And so while we've maintained all of our districts' healthy CTE programs, they are not what they were 5 years ago. The second one is the cost of those programs. If you're running a Woods or a Metals or a Culinary Arts programs, those are hugely expensive. And while there's federal dollars called Perkins that Mark is real close to, that dollar amount has decreased and been increasingly focused on a very important professional development for a lot of those teachers, but there's not enough to maintain the equipment. And so bonds are huge. So for example, if you have a high school where you have a metal shop, a wood shop, those kinds of things, you write into the bond the large fiscal cost of updating that equipment so that you can maintain those programs. But again, that's a piece of it, but also it's staffing them. Our neighbors in Oregon Trail School District are a great example of, you can have the most beautiful facilities in the world, which they do, their high schools like to die for, but they have an auto shop that's not staffed. They don't have the program because they don't have the ability to hire enough teachers in those programs. So it's two sides to that coin, and we all struggle with both.
Hello, my name's Kate. I work for Multnomah County. In my professional field and also personally, I'm really passionate about kids and traffic safety and encouraging walking, biking, access to transit. And I know that this isn't a responsibility of school districts, but I'd love to hear your thoughts on how can school districts improve these opportunities for safer walking, biking, transit, traffic safety, and if you had suggestions for community groups or agencies that would like to work with you and partner on that.
I haven't had the mic, that's right. Yeah, I know of that, to have safer sidewalks going to schools. For example, right where our district office is, we have our Reynolds Middle School, we have Salish Ponds, and we also have Reynolds Learning Academy. So we have three huge schools right on one area. Yet on 201st, there are no sidewalks for kids to be able to walk to school. It's much safer for them to be picked up by our school buses, which we do more because of the busy urban type of area that we live in. I know that when we're building new schools, we put in better sidewalks. For example, in Fairview, Fairview has, I'm trying to think of what, they have redone their areas around the school so that they have good sidewalks, but you also have to have safe areas. And truthfully, it's not very safe in a lot of our areas in the schools. So it would cost more. You would have to have either volunteers out watching kids as they're walking, maybe have adults walk with them. But we really think that transportation, our school buses, are the safest route to school.
I would add to that in terms of really a shout out here to the city of Gresham. Our schools that are within the city of Gresham receive a different level of attention because of that municipality. So we've seen real improvements in front of a lot of schools, Gordon Russell, Powell Valley, where we have crosswalk markings, and improvements over the last 5-10 years have really been made a huge difference in terms of safety. But we have a lot of schools that are out in the middle of nowhere. And so if you go to Barlow and Damascus and those places, I mean, you've got 18-inch shoulders and 6 feet deep ditches. So kids can't walk to school, even if they wanted to. So it's really just depends on location and who's serving that location. But I will also tell you, in our early work for the bond, one of the key features of every school is to address the bus and the car drop-off flow, and redesigned our schools. When a lot of these schools were built, students either came on a bus, or they walked, or they rode their bikes. You go out to, for example, East Orient Elementary School, you've got a mile-long stack of cars dropping their kids off. Now, I'm not going to judge whether they should or shouldn't do that, but the reality is those schools weren't built with drop-off and pickup zones that accommodate that, so we jam up streets all over the place every morning, every afternoon. So when we redesign buildings, we need to really design into the plan how to get traffic in and out and keep kids safe.
I would just add real quick to that. Of course, we had the issue outside Centennial High earlier this year, and the city of Gresham was a great partner in responding quickly to that, and we've had zero incidents since, and we hope to keep that true as well. Really, the biggest issue is East County has grown in a way that was not planned or accommodated for. And so we have many schools which are technically within walking distance of the entire neighborhood they serve, but they have to cross busy streets without adequate safe zones. And so part of the work that we do, and you're right, it may not be the responsibility for schools, but we care about our students and want them safe, as we do spend a lot of time working with and lobbying Multnomah County and working with the Department of Transportation and those pieces. And then some of our schools do sit out in unincorporated Multnomah County, and where there are no walking paths or anything at all, and it does cause traffic issues. One thing I will say is if we do build our new middle school, we know we're going to end up being responsible for putting a light on 172nd Foster. So everyone seems to feel like that will be a fantastic thing, because all of us have been sitting there waiting to turn left or right one time or another. So that's not the walking piece, but that will be a transportation benefit to everyone.
Any other questions? So I read a statistic a little while back that pointed out that Oregon students K through 12 spend about 1 year less time in the classroom than our students across the river. Why is that? And what are we going to do about it?
It's actually, the data is even more stark than that. That's true, but that's the average for the nation. But if you look at some of the, particularly over in the East County, Eastern United States, actually it's more like a year and a half. And of course the real issue there is, so the kids that cross our stages here over the next 2 weeks as high school graduates and are competing for scholarships, have had a year less to prepare to compete for the scholarships that every other kid in the country and in the world is competing for. So it is a problem. Over time, the state has been minimal in terms of growth for funding that allows for longer years. So the state of Washington, on the other hand, actually over the long run has funded and increased their school years, and we haven't. In fact, from year to year, our actually have decreased. We've all had our furlough or budget reduction days. The data you're having there suggests a full year. It's really worse for any kid who's a senior now in our district. 5 of their 13 years in school were shortened because of budget reductions. So it's even more than a year. But it really has been over time. It's a funding level. We also are 46th in the nation in funding on education. So, you know, we're a business where 80% of the dollars pay for people. So your primary cost is really the people that work in our schools. If you pay them less, quite often they work less, which is the shorter school year.
compared to other places.
I can do without that.
Yeah, right.
But they can.
It seems that a lot of what we've heard about funding through schools is a systemic problem within the state's methodology for funding education. When you look at our neighbors to the north, they've earmarked timber taxes and other set asides in revenue streams to provide a much more consistent methodology for funding education. Because you all stay connected at a state level very well. Have you heard of dialogue, or do you know of anybody working on anything that might start to correct this problem that we have with educational funding?
You know, some of the conversations I've heard for many years, it's always been sometimes the solution that comes out is a sales tax, okay?
But you know, that's like, know, pumping gas. It seems to be pretty divisive across the state as to whether we would ever go there. But that would be a leveling piece that would keep the highs and lows. The most recent one, and again, I won't wade into the politics too much, but certainly there's conversation of, had the kicker in past years been invested in a rainy day fund, then the valleys of a recession, which are pretty dark in the state of Oregon, could have been leveled off. So certainly that conversation is out there. Not a lot of folks necessarily ask us as educators about our opinion, and I'm not sure that it's our role as educational leaders to weigh in as much as it is as a citizen. But certainly I would agree with you, the revenue source needs to be leveled in such a way that there will always be ups and downs in the economy. That's fine. It's just our downs can't be so low, because it does cost us to dismantle good school systems and then spend forever to try to get almost back to where you were, only to dismantle again. And there's not that buffer out there.
And the state needs to see education as a priority. And they have not, just by taking a look at the slide that I started out with that showed the funding level going from the 40% down to the 39% of the piece of the pie. So even though this biennium, when the economy has risen, our funding dropped. So there is no priority at the state level for education.
So, Mayor, last question.
I'm just wondering, I've heard a lot of the conversation today has been focused on the state and the amount of funding that they provide, and that is where a lot of our issues have come from. And I'm wondering, rather than look at a bond measure to fix this, some of the schools or whatever, if we wouldn't be better to get together and sort of think about a revenue bond that would go to fund to bring class sizes down, or to add certain athletics, or to bring back certain programs. In other words, rather than go, you know, put lipstick on the problem, why don't we fix the problem? Because our schools, as I see it, are in dire straits in East County. I mean, I don't think there's any way. I mean, we are making progress, and I commend that progress, and we've got a lot of work to do on our end too. But it seems to me that until we, East County, figure out how to control our own destiny absent the state, that might be a pathway to go forward to start to get the class sizes down, to get the athletics back, to get, you know, schools the way that, you know, we were all raised to be. And there are places in the state that are doing that. I mean, Portland does that. I just think waiting around for the state to fix anything is fool's gold.
You know, Multnomah County ITAX did just that for Multnomah County. Was it 2002?
I can't remember. So the Multnomah County ITAX was that regional effort, and those 3 years of extra taxes panned out for most of us into 5 to 6 years of dollars, because we wanted to try to sustain them. And it accomplished that purpose. It was during a tough economic time. It kind of buoyed everybody up and got us forward. So there is precedent of that happening. The added feature, though, that's difficult, you mentioned, is now individual districts go out for local options. And so if you're in a voter group where they are very amenable to that kind of added taxing themselves, Portland Public, Beaverton, Lake Oswego, what do these all have in common? It tends to be pretty thriving socioeconomic centers. They vote yes, and so we are really back in a very small degree into pre-measure five haves and have-nots in this state. There's probably a dozen districts across the state that are the have districts. They tax themselves to increase their operational levels. The rest of the state is off of the state school fund, which is a lower level. So there is a contrast between Portland Public, what they can do, than the other five counties' schools. So I would agree with you. I think that kind of regional approach, whether it's county, I don't know what the municipality of East County is, who can come together, but I think you would certainly get us willingly sitting at a table to talk through possibilities in terms of that added support.
I'm not convinced that the public can support it.
Yeah.
Even the high tax.
Right.
On behalf of the Gresham Chamber of Commerce, I first want to thank our guests, our three superintendents, for being here today and for sharing the information that you have with our community, not only those present in this room today, but through MetroEast in future broadcasts of today's program. It's all an important part of education for our community to understand the status of our current schools. I want to thank you for being here, all of you, and for your faithfulness in coming to the Government Affairs Forum. I also want to thank our sponsors who have provided this for us month after month, the Portland General Electric, Riverview Community Bank, Gresham-Barlow School District, and MetroEast Community Media. These are important components to our provision of this forum to you. I want to remind you on behalf of my good friend Larry Schwartz over there from Riverview Community Bank, and on behalf of Shelley, who works in the office, please take the cups home with you so she doesn't have to take them home and wash them. I would invite you, our next forum is on July 7. I would invite you back to celebrate my birthday with our guest, Bob Packwood. So you will want to come and hear Bob Packwood on July 7. And you may leave the room today, go back to your home, to your office, and you may go online right now to GreshamChamber.org, and you may register for Bob Packwood's presentation next month. So please do that. And lastly, as you leave, we would really appreciate if you would take a few seconds of your time to complete the evaluation forms that are on the table. Leave them there, and we will collect them and process them afterwards. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and have a wonderful day. Enjoy this beautiful state of Oregon. Thank you. Thank you.